This is now a widely accepted explanation for the occurrence of synesthesia, although it was a radical when it was first proposed. This EMT hypothesis supports the view that detection of intersensory equivalence is present from birth, and that perceptual development is characterized by gradual differentiation. 2.7 The neonatal synesthesia hypothesis. The neonatal synesthesia hypothesis builds on this EMT evidence, but suggests that early in infancy, probably up to about 4 months of age, all human babies experience sensory input in an undifferentiated way. Sounds trigger auditory, visual and tactile experiences all at once. Following this early initial phase of normal synesthesia, the different sensory modalities became increasingly modular. Adult synesthesia has been suggested to be as a result of a breakdown in the process of modularization, such that during infancy the modularization process was not completed. This of course implies that if not now, then at some time in the past, we have all experienced synesthetic perception. 3 Synesthesia and Art 3.1 Photisms and Color Hearing Synesthesia. In color hearing synesthesia, a photism, usually colored in some way, appears in the field of vision of a synesthete as a response to some form of oral stimuli. Synesthetic photisms usually vary in shape and color according to the nature of the stimuli that trigger them. The examples below represent some different photisms. As can be seen above, synesthetes never see complex dream-like scenes or have otherwise elaborate percepts. They perceive blobs, lines, spirals, lattices, and other geometric shapes. 4. Dr. Richard Cytowick notes that the generic and restricted nature of synesthetic percepts bear a considerable likeness to a series of forms first developed by Heinrich Kluver in the 1920s known as Kluver's form constants. 5. These generic shapes are common to synesthesia, hallucinations, and are frequently seen in primitive art. Figure 2.2 Kluver's form constants variations in photism color, brightness, symmetry, and shapes have been recorded to vary as a result of variation in musical stimuli. Tempo, for instance, affects the shape of a photism. The faster the music, the sharper and more angular the photism. That pitch has a direct effect on the size of a photism has also been recorded. It has been observed universally that photism size increases as auditory pitch decreases. In this way, high-pitched sounds produce small photisms and low-pitched sounds produce synesthetic percepts that are large in size. Loudness also has an effect on the size of the photism perceived by a synesthete. Lawrence E. Marx shared his understanding of synesthetic response to music. Just as the important dimensions of the auditory stimulus that are responsible for musical synesthesia can be quite complex, so too can be the synesthetic responses themselves. Visual sensations aroused by music need not be limited or confined to simple spots of color. Often the entire visual field fills with colors that change over time with the music. Some subjects report several colors simultaneously, each color reflecting a particular aspect of the music. 6. 3.2 Musical Perception in Synesthesia. It is of interest to open this section by quoting the concerns of one group of psychologists who conducted numerous investigations into synesthesia during the first half of this century. Published in the Journal of General Psychology in 1942, they write, "Although it is generally agreed that relationships between visual and auditory experiences exist commonly in our language forms, nevertheless, we have no quantitative measure of just how common a given relationship between sound and sight actually is in the population. Such a measure would be useful to determine what percent of an audience could be expected to grasp an artist's purpose if, for example, you represented the harmony of his musical composition by background and the melody by figures in his color music production. Also, it would facilitate the process of conventionalizing associations between music and vision if one could determine quantitatively which of several acceptable ways of representing the melody, for instance, is already predominantly in use I. is considered appropriate by most people. 7. At least 23 psychological publications between 1862 and 1974 concerned themselves with correlations between sound composition and color as a result of research directed at synesthesia. Many more have concerned themselves with studies of synesthesia triggered by speech stimulus. Research into these areas of synesthesia has furnished artists with some information by which to start developing the formulations suggested in the quote from 1942 above. In his article, On Colored Hearing Synesthesia, originally published in the Psychological Bulletin, Lawrence E. Marks compiled all the information extant on such matters into a series of tables printed below. 8. 3.3 Vowel color. The study of chromesthetic phenomena often concerns itself with associations triggered by speech rather than music. This is perhaps due to the fact that speech is pathologically superior in its ability to evoke a synesthetic response. The component of speech that bears the greatest influence on the nature of the induced response is the sound of vowels. Both areas have tremendous significance in mapping out perceptual parallels between the modalities of hearing and vision. Firstly, when it comes to reports on musical synesthesia, we find that the important principles of visual auditory association that manifest themselves in color music are basically the same principles that manifest themselves in colored vowels, that is, the relations of visual brightness and size to auditory pitch and loudness. Secondly, in an article published in 1968, Wayne Slauson showed that artificial two-formant sounds are readily interpretable as vowels and as musical notes, and that the vowel quality and musical timbre depend in similar ways on the structure of the sound, form and frequency, and spectrum envelope. 3.4 Slauson sound color. Slauson went on to elaborate his comparison of vowel sounds to the field of musical timbre in his sound color of 1985. In this book, Slauson uses the four characteristics set out by Chomsky and Holley in 1968 in the sound patterns of English and adapts them so as to form a basis for organizing musical timbre derived from various sources. Besides being the only text to date to take up Arnold Schoenberg's 1911 request for a treatise on the subject of playing on Farbe, sound color forms an essential bridge between the colors commonly associated with vowel sounds and the form and composition of synthesized sounds with which Slauson is largely concerned. Slauson indicates that sound color is primarily a function of the frequencies of the first two resonances. Slauson uses the three categories by which vowel features are organized: compactness, acuteness and laxness, changing compactness to openness, and adding a fourth category, smallness, which has no corresponding vowel feature. For conclusion, the nature of synesthetic perception does not on its own provide artists with a template for mapping between visual and auditory arts. Whilst it describes the constant nature of the relationship between brightness and pitch, brightness and volume, photon shape and oral texture, it does not map hue to timbre or pitch in any way not related to a particular musical context. Also, because synesthetic photons are two-dimensional in nature, research into synesthesia can shed limited light on relationships between music and objects with three dimensions.